I am Mr. Drew. In this video, we're going to be talking about side splitting. Not humor, math. We're going to be looking in this video and the next more proportions in triangles. As if we haven't already done enough with all the similar triangles and introduction to ratios and proportions and similar polygons. This one's going to be about parallel lines going through, in the beginning, parallel lines going through a triangle. We're going to do a theorem, corollary, and two examples. I'm trying to keep this video shorter than most of my videos. If a line is parallel to one side of a triangle and intersects the other two sides of the triangle, sounds a lot like the mid-segment theorem, but we're not connecting the midpoints, then it divides those sides proportionally. Kind of makes sense if you think about it. Parallel lines are two lines that never cross, they never touch. That means that they have to be in the same plane. They have to be coplanar. If they never cross within the same plane, then the distance between those two parallel lines must stay constant at all times. And in a triangle, what that means is that, let's just take this on the left and the right, that segment BD over DA is going to be equal to BE over EC. And we've learned, about ratio and proportions now. There's other little small variations we can make to this equation and still have a valid proportion as long as we're consistent in both of those fractions. I'm going to keep it top to bottom on the left and right hand sides that are getting intersected by this parallel line of segment of DE and or line. So we got some information here. We're going to use the fact that these two sides, the proportion of these two sides is equal to these two, and solve for x. So let's keep it in the same order as this formula just for convenience and go down, down on the left and right. So BD has a length of x plus 3. DA has a length of x. So I'm going from top to bottom again. Now let's set up for the right-hand side. BE is equal to 10. And EC is equal to 6. Break my chalks all the time. Now, hopefully by now, we've done a lot of proportions, so you know that if an equation has one fraction on the left and one fraction on the right, then you have the option, probably the easiest option of solving that is to just simply cross multiply. Can't do that if there's more than one fraction on one side of your equation. So let's see here. Let's do 6 times x plus 3. That's equal to 10x, almost forgot my x there. We can't solve for an equation when it has parentheses in it, usually. Well, at some point they're going to have to go anyway, so I'm going to take that 6 and multiply it through the parentheses. There's no plus or minus there, so it's multiplication. 6 times x is 6x. We have 6 times 3, which is 18. And that is equal to 10x. Well, if you're trying to solve for a variable, of course, you eventually at some point need to get all the variables on the same side. I have a constant of 18 over here on the left already, so I'm going to leave that there and just move the positive 6 from the left side of the equation over to the right, again doing the inverse or opposite math operation. And we're going to get 18 equals 4x. I'm going to divide by 4. And get x. I didn't leave myself very much room here. Instead of reducing this, let's just go right to a mixed fraction. How many 4s can you pull values of 4 can you put into 18? 4. 4 times 4 is 16. Okay, so if 4 times 4 is 16, that's going to give me a remainder of 2, but I'm dividing by 4, so it's really 4 and remainder of 2 over 4. Well, 2 over 4 reduces down to 1/2. And if all we're looking for is the value of x, then we're done. If we're actually looking for these segments, then don't forget to take your value of 4.5 and plug it into all these, these first two expressions to find their actual length. And if you want to go even farther and check your work, make sure those proportions are equal. I mean, the theorem says they are. Now, corollary to the side splitter theorem, if three parallel lines intersect two transversals, remember a transversal is just a line going through a bunch of parallel lines. Then again, keeping that idea that, if these three lines are parallel, then the distance between these two lines are never going to change, and the distance between these two lines are never going to change. So there's some nice relationships here between, you know, these two segments and these two segments. Probably should have exaggerated the angle of one of my lines here, because AB is not necessarily equal to DE. When you measure the distance between two lines, you measure, you know, in a perpendicular fashion. Well, you know, so while the distance between these lines never changes because they're parallel and, you know, coplanar, as I lean over, as my transversal leans over, the distance you would have to travel to get through each of those lines is, of course, going to be longer. So AB is not equal to DE because these are what's called oblique lines. They're not intersecting in a right angle. Just to clarify that a little bit. So three parallel lines. We have two transversals going through those three parallel lines at any angle that they choose. And what you have, again, is this equal ratio. AB over BC is going to be equal to DE over EF. We're just going to, it's going to look just like this example here, but I'm going to include one more just to make sure you completely understand what's going on. So let me get the left side of this board erased and get our last example done. Now, I don't want to just work another example and have it be just exactly like the last one. Turn the ceiling fan off there so I don't have to hear it. So this question, this example I'm about to go through has got some pretty extensive algebra in it. I might even have to erase this half of the board to finish it. I want to continue that algebra review. Is, you know, we want to just not focus on the geometry, but remember all that algebra you learned from the previous year that you're going to use in the next year if you're taking algebra geometry between your Algebra 1 and Algebra 2 course. And I also want to remind you that we're doing geometry problems, not pure algebra. So when we're done, we're going to have to make sure that our answers are valid, you know, for this diagram, that I don't have negative measurements or such like that. So let's see here. We've got 2x plus 1 over x minus 1. And on the other side, we have 3x over 3x minus 10. We're going to go ahead and cross multiply this, and that means that we're going to have 2x plus 1 times 3x minus 10 is equal to 3x times x minus 1. Okay, well, lots of algebra here to do. I got two binomials on the left-hand side. We want to distribute those together. I hate the idea of the FOIL concept, so I'm going to just say that we need to distribute these binomials together. I don't like FOIL, first, outer, inner, last, because what happens when you have a trinomial? So just make sure that every term in the first factor gets multiplied to every term in the second factor, and each one of these little cheater lines I'm drawing to kind of help me make sure I'm doing this right represents multiplication. So we have 2x times 3x, which is 6x squared. We have 2x times negative 10, which is negative 20x. We have positive 3x and negative 10. That's going to be equal to 3x times x, which is 3x squared minus 3x. Well, we got to get everything on one side. We're not going to just get x alone here because we have squared terms and single degree terms, so we're not going to be able to just like a sort of like a linear equation get x by itself. We're going to get the set equal to 0 and figure out what happens then. So we're going to subtract both sides by 3x squared. Add, I'm going to kind of do two things at once to, maybe I'm doing this a little bit too early because I haven't put these like terms together yet. So let's forget about adding that 3x right now and clean things up. We have 6 minus 3, which is 3x squared. We have negative 20 plus 3, which is negative 17. And let me just, it's rattling, it's bothering me. Okay, now we can get that 3x over to the other side with addition. And we get 3x squared minus 14x minus 10 is equal to 0. I'm going to pause this because it keeps rattling every time I write. It's better. Okay, so when you have a quadratic equation with a leading coefficient that's not equal to 1, how are you going to deal with it? Well, you could factor it if it's factorable. Now, If you forget how to factor, you might want to look up my videos on reminding you of how to do that. I'll just quickly say, when your leading coefficient is not equal to 1, you want to take your leading coefficient and your constant, multiply them together, so it's going to be 3 times negative 10, which is negative 30. If there's factors of that product that add up to the middle term, then it's factorable. If there's not, well, then it's not. And this is not going to be factorable. So what that means is, we're going to have to use the quadratic formula to finish solving this, which is x is equal to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. And when your equation's in standard form, like mine is, with the squared term first, single degree term, and then my constant left, well, this first number is a, this second number is b, and the constant is c. So we're just going to have to be very careful with our order of operations as we go through this problem. And we get x is equal to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac. If I get too crowded, actually I think I'm going to get too crowded. Let me go ahead and pause this and erase part of this. Okay. So negative b plus or minus b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. Now, you notice I didn't even look at the numbers. The reason why I did that is because when it seemed like my b is negative, a lot of students, when they're plugging in a number that is negative into an equation that already has a negative sign, they think they don't have to include both, but you absolutely do. So if you get in the habit of writing your formula out first with all your parentheses where you're going to do your substitution, you'll make much fewer mistakes with your signs. So we have the opposite, I've been saying negative, but the opposite of b, which is negative 14, is plus or minus negative 14 squared minus 4 times a, which is 3, times c, which is negative 10, all over 2a, which is 3. Okay, so now what we have is, we've got, let's go this way, we've got a positive 14 plus or minus the square root of, I believe 14 squared is 196. Yep, 196. And we've got negative 4 times 3, which is negative 12, times negative 10, which is positive 120. Or excuse me. Yes, in my notes I thought that 3 times 2 was equal to 5, but not 6, so I had to redo my notes to finish this up. I was going to reshoot it, thought about reshooting it, but yeah, you know, I make mistakes, we all make mistakes, so I'll let you see mine. At any rate, this is all right so far. So we want to finish this up, and let's carry this over here. We have 14 plus or minus the square root of 100, 200, 290, 310, 316 over 6. Now, I can't do the square root of 316 in my head. It actually simplifies a little bit, but we're going to go ahead and just put this in a decimal form. And let me refer to my new notes. We have 14 here. Okay, so we have 14 plus the square root of 316 is 17.78, roughly, and over 6. And that comes out to be 31.78 over 6. And that comes out to be 5.3. Okay. So not only are we going to get a review of how to do the quadratic formula, and I apparently need one for myself on how to multiply binomials together, but I also need to now figure out, okay, I got a positive 5.3. If you take 5.3 and plug it into these expressions, we get all positive measurements. So this is a reasonable number, and we should be good. When we go to work out the subtraction part of this radical, though, we got to be careful with the last part. So let me just pick another color, because it's going to be wrong. We have 14 minus, let's put over here, the square root of 316 again, which is 17.78, divided by 6. And you're going to do 14 minus 17.78, which is going to be negative 3.3. 0.78 divided by 6, and there's a decimal to that, but I can go ahead and stop because this is going to be a negative answer. This is a geometry problem. These expressions represent the lengths of the distances between these parallel lines, or the length of these segments of the transversal, and you cannot have that negative number times a positive 3 right there. We're going to have a negative distance, and I already know, therefore, that this is going to be an invalid answer. So again, not all your geometry problems necessarily have to have like really easy algebra. In this case, we certainly did not. And when you're done, make sure you check the validity of your answers, because again, this isn't pure algebra and you can't have a negative measurement. So, I'm Mr. Taru. Bam! Go do your homework and check your work as you go.